The following episode contains descriptions of sexual violence and may not be suitable for everyone. Please see the episode notes for more information about support services.
It's November 1993. Steven Hoffenberg is in his late 40s, with coiffed hair and round cheeks that puff out when he grins. Hoffenberg is known around New York as a quintessential Wall Street master of the universe. Recently, he bailed out the financially troubled tabloid, the New York Post. He turns up at society functions, and he's rented a whole floor in Trump Tower. He made his fortune running a company called Towers Financial, which bought up debts like unpaid medical bills and got the debtors to pay them. At its peak, Towers had 1,200 employees. It was worth an estimated $95 million. But Hoffenberg's business tactics haven't always been above board. The SEC's been investigating him for years, and now they have enough evidence to put together a case. Today, Hoffenberg sits inside a grand jury chamber in Chicago. With Towers Financial, they allege, Hoffenberg operated one of the biggest financial frauds in U.S. history, cheating investors out of more than $450 million. Hoffenberg is planning to cooperate with the government and tell them more about his scheme, and also about the man he claims engineered it, his business partner, Jeffrey Epstein. Hoffenberg takes his seat before the jury. The prosecutor approaches and asks Hoffenberg to walk them through the plan he and Epstein devised step by step. Hoffenberg and Epstein targeted people who didn't have much money, retirees, widows, the disabled, and promised healthy returns on their investment. But instead, they used the money to cover losses in other risky business deals, and hundreds of thousands of people lost their life savings. It was a classic Ponzi scheme. Again and again, the prosecutor asked who designed the scam and the complex stock manipulations it required. Hoffenberg always answers with the same name. Jeffrey Epstein was the person in charge of the transactions. Epstein was trying to manipulate the price of the stock? Yes. You didn't object to that, sir? No. Hoffenberg is sentenced for the scheme and serves nearly two decades in prison. To this day, Hoffenberg still says the same thing he said to prosecutors back then.
He was the mastermind, brilliant Wall Street executive that was an expert in what was taking place at the company that was doing the criminal misconduct. He was brilliant at it. Totally brilliant at it. He participated in everything with me 24/7.
But when reporters from the Washington Post later look at this case, they find something strange. Even though Hoffenberg's grand jury testimony gave detailed, damning evidence that Epstein was deeply involved in the scheme, Epstein's involvement vanishes from the case. And while Hoffenberg went to prison for years, Epstein was never charged. Today, Hoffenberg claims that the money Epstein made from their Ponzi scheme became the foundation for his fortune. But digging into the origins of Jeffrey Epstein's wealth is more complicated than that. Where his money came from is still a question reporters are trying to answer. But a few things are certain. Federal investigators questioned Epstein about shady financial deals, yet he was never indicted. And his fortunes rose when, as a young man on Wall Street, he was able to charm and win the trust of a few corporate titans, including, in particular, one lonely billionaire.
We get support from Madison Reed. Your face unlocks your phone. You just asked your watch to remind you to send your mom a birthday card. There's a lot at your disposal these days that can make life a little easier. And why should hair color be any different? Madison Reed at-home hair color starts at just $22. It's simple to get started. You go online, take their color quiz to find your perfect shade, and they'll deliver it right to your door. With Madison Reed, you'll get all the good stuff. Gorgeous, multidimensional color with nourishing ingredients like argan oil and keratin, without a lot of the bad stuff that usually comes with it. There's no ammonia and no smell whatsoever. And if you're worried about trying to color your hair at home, don't be. I'm a Madison Reed customer. I've used them several times to color my own hair. And with all of the resources and support they give you, it's a piece of cake. Become a pro at coloring your hair at home with the help of the actual pros at Madison Reed. Head to madison-reed.com right now to get started. Use our promo code MYE and you'll get 10% off plus free shipping on your first color kit. That's promo code MYE. Visit madison-reed.com now to find your perfect shade.
From Wondery, I'm Lindsey Graham, host of American Scandal, and this is The Mysterious Mr. Epstein. This is episode 2, Poor, Smart, and Desperate. It's the spring of 1969 at Lafayette High School in South Brooklyn. Jeffrey Epstein is 16 years old. A photo in his senior yearbook shows him in his graduation gown, shoulders slouched, posing for the camera, but looking like his mind is elsewhere. Another photo, taken around the same time, shows him shirtless and cut-off jeans, his feet in the sand of Coney Island Beach. He has a wild mess of hair and a pudgy torso, and again he's slouched over. The young man is a whiz at math and science, and a member of the school band. Epstein and his family live in Coney Island, in a cluster of middle-class homes surrounded by the flat, gray-blue water of the Brooklyn seaside. Countless news outlets have reported that Epstein's father, Seymour, worked for the Parks Department, and on Seymour's death certificate, the Parks Department is listed as his employer. But the truth is, Seymour only worked there for 3 months in 1960. Almost like everything else in Epstein's origin story, even his father is a mysterious footnote. After Epstein graduates, he attends Cooper Union for 2 years. Then he enrolls at New York University. But he drops out in the summer of 74 without earning a degree. But this is where he makes his first leap up the New York social ladder. At 21 years old, he lands a job teaching math and physics at one of the most prestigious private high schools in the country, where he'll leave a strong impression on the children of New York's elite and their fathers. It's the fall of 1975 at the Dalton School on Manhattan's Upper East Side. The school looks unassuming from the outside, an austere brick building, windows studded with air conditioners. But inside, its classrooms are filled with the children of celebrities and captains of industry. Between classes, Mr. Epstein mingles with his students. He's got a magnetism now that eluded him in his high school days. He'll later be photographed for the school yearbook, wearing a suit jacket and a shirt with a flared-out collar, unbuttoned, revealing his chest and a gold chain. Peter Branch, who was head of the upper school at the time, remembers when Epstein arrived.
With a person like Epstein, who could teach physics and higher-level math, skills that are still in rare supply in the school world, and with clearly ability to convince people that he was something that he wasn't, it's not surprising to me that he was hired.
Many students like Mr. Epstein. On top of teaching math and physics, he also coaches the school's math team. He even performs for the spring musical, with the school paper noting that Mr. Epstein proved himself to be the ivory showman on the piano. Epstein doesn't behave like the other teachers. He attends a party at a student's house where students are drinking. He flirts with girls in the hallways. Rumors circulate about Epstein's relationship with one girl in particular. He's never accused of any crimes, but the New York Times will later report that a few students were, quote, so discomfited by a close relationship he had with one of their female peers that one of them had raised the issue to a school administrator. Students at Dalton come from some of the wealthiest families in the country. Their parents aren't easily impressed, but Mr. Epstein makes an impression. It's through Dalton that Epstein manages to meet Ace Greenberg, a legend on Wall Street. And it turns out that Epstein is exactly the sort of man that Ace Greenberg likes to recruit. Like Epstein, Greenberg comes from modest means. He arrived in New York looking for work during the recession of 1949.
I finally did get a job as a clerk at Bear Stearns. and it was $32.50 a week. That didn't go very far then. And I know the prices were cheaper then than they are now, but I can tell you that it still didn't go very far. It didn't go anyplace.
Still in his early 50s, Greenberg's risen through the ranks of the investment bank Bear Stearns. And Greenberg's background dictates his hiring philosophy. He's on the lookout for what he calls PSDs, employees who are poor, smart, and desperate to get rich. Greenberg thinks Epstein is an ideal hire for Bear Stearns. For a long time, Epstein's origin story was that Dalton opened his eyes to a world of boundless wealth, influence, and power. So he quit the teaching gig, and with talent to spare, he went out to make his mark and his millions on Wall Street. But the head of the upper school, Peter Branch, says Epstein didn't take the job seriously, that he was falling short of Dalton's standards. So Branch asked him to leave. In 1976, Epstein starts at Bear Stearns as a junior assistant floor trader, but he's talented and he quickly moves up the ladder. Within just 4 years, Epstein's a limited partner at Bear Stearns. Most 27-year-old college dropouts would consider themselves on a glide path to comfort and security, but not Epstein. He abruptly leaves Bear Stearns a year later. He'll tell people it was because he wanted more, that he wanted to start his own firm. He wanted to help the super rich, quote, understand the power, the responsibility, and the burden of their money. But once again, that's not the whole truth. It's April Fool's Day, 1981, just 3 weeks after Epstein resigned from Bear Stearns. He's being questioned by the Securities and Exchange Commission about allegations of insider trading around a mineral company called the St. Joe Minerals Corporation. The SEC investigators start in on Epstein. Sir, are you aware that certain rumors may have been circulating around your firm in connection with your reasons for leaving the firm? I'm aware there were many rumors. What were the rumors you heard? Nothing to do with St. Joe. Has anyone indicated to you in any way, either directly or indirectly, in words or substance, that your compensation for this past year or any future monies coming to you from Bear Stearns will be contingent upon your not divulging information to the Securities and Exchange Commission? No. The questioning goes on, but the SEC never brings charges against Epstein or anyone else at Bear Stearns. Epstein later admits that part of why he left Bear Stearns was over an illegal loan to an old friend. He claims he didn't know it was illegal, but that it cost him his shot at becoming a full partner. Nevertheless, when Epstein leaves, he still gets his annual bonus of $100,000. But the bonus doesn't last long, and soon Epstein is reportedly broke. He needs a new plan. Jeffrey Epstein stands in front of a building in Midtown Manhattan called the Villard House. It's as long as a city block and has touches of an Italian palazzo and was once the residence of a railroad tycoon. Epstein's new business partner set him up with an office at this coveted address. He's paying Epstein $25,000 a month to serve as his business consultant. His new business partner is named Stephen Hoffenberg, the head of Towers Financial. Together, Epstein and Hoffenberg come up with a new business venture. They take money from retirees on the pretense of safe investments and then use them to keep their own aggressive business ventures afloat. But when the investments nosedive, all $460 million of the retirees' money is lost in the wreckage. Hoffenberg gets indicted and ends up in prison. Prosecutors, though, do nothing to pursue Epstein further. To this day, Hoffenberg claims not to understand why.
There's no explanation for not charging Epstein at that time. There's none, because he should have been charged.
So Epstein skates out of one of the largest Ponzi schemes in American history and back to running his advisory firm, J. Epstein & Co. Epstein boasts that it has only one rule, billionaires only. If you only have $999 million to your name, take a hike. But if you have $1 billion, J. Epstein & Company will happily shoulder the burden of managing your wealth. Which leads to a very fruitful relationship with the only billionaire he'll ever publicly confirm is a client of J. Epstein & Company. A billionaire who turned a single clothing store into a retail empire that would include Abercrombie & Fitch and Victoria's Secret. His name is Les Wexner, and he's the man who made Jeffrey Epstein.
If you're looking for a bit of escapism, try getting lost in the Richlands family drama. The story starts with Eleanor and Michael Richland having just lost their parents in a plane crash. As they reckon with this tragedy, something about their father's legacy just isn't adding up. The siblings come face to face with two choices: protect the family empire or risk losing everything to find the truth. You can subscribe to Blood Ties on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you're listening now.
Hey, podcast listeners, I'm Justin Long. I'm the host of another Wondery show called Life is Short. This week on the show, we have Judd Apatow. It does not get more influential in the world of comedy than Judd, and I've worked with him a couple times but hadn't seen him in a while. So if you'd like to hear us catch up, talk about the old days, talk about so much of Judd's great work, please subscribe to Life is Short and other great Wondery shows wherever you're listening right now.
It's the late 1980s, and Jeffrey Epstein is flying first class from New York to Palm Beach. Sitting beside him is a man named Robert Meister. Epstein's been known to use bogus upgrade stickers to get a seat at the front of the plane, but Meister is a man who belongs in first class. He's the vice chairman of a large insurance company called Aon. One of his biggest clients, and a man he considers his friend, is Leslie Wexner, the billionaire founder of a company called The Limited. Sitting next to him, something about Epstein catches Meister's attention. They talk the entire flight. He's an interesting, charming guy, Meister thinks. He files Epstein's name away in his mental Rolodex. Sometime later, according to one author's account, Wexner confides in Meister that he's having problems with the people managing his money. And Meister recalls that engaging man he met on the plane. He offers to introduce Wexner to Epstein, which he does. Soon, Epstein and Wexner are working together. And here's another place where the facts seem to shift. Epstein reportedly brags to friends that he first met Wexner back in 1986 and won his trust by convincing him to keep his money out of stocks just before the 87 market crash. But if that story is true, it means that Epstein was already managing Wexner's billions at the same time he was running a Ponzi scheme with Hoffenberg. When a reporter for Vanity Fair points this out, Epstein insists that it wasn't until 89, well after the crash, that he started working with Wexner. Either way, Jeffrey Epstein is about to become very, very rich. Leslie Wexner is in his early 50s. He's sharply dressed, with a trim build and a winning smile that somehow says, "Can you believe I'm a billionaire? What luck?" That's the public persona anyway. At least one of his friends says Wexner is a lonely man, isolated by his success and vulnerable. But even a lonely billionaire running a huge company will have layers of staff, advisors, and lieutenants. What's unusual about Epstein as he enters Wexner's life is how quickly he penetrates Wexner's inner circle. Soon, it seems Epstein's the only one in that circle, patrolling the long halls at L. Brand's HQ, visiting Wexner's Ohio mansion, overseeing construction of Wexner's 100 million black-hulled triple-decker superyacht. He torments Wexner's employees and aggravates the billionaire's friends. Bob Fitrakis, a political science professor and former journalist who wrote for an alt-weekly newspaper in Ohio, remembers what people were saying at the time.
Every time Wexner's name was mentioned, Jeff Epstein's name was mentioned as his sort of fixer, logistic guy, or financial man. And everyone knew that Jeff Epstein spoke for Les Wexner, that he was empowered. Now, is he a glorified valet? Is he a fixer? Is he a forcer? Is he a lover? I mean, how suddenly is he in charge of, you know, all Wexner's finances and dealings?
Epstein becomes more and more involved in aspects of Wexner's life. He goes from overseeing the building of Wexner's yacht and dealings with friends and family to even replacing Wexner's own mother on the board of his charitable foundation. Then, on July 30th, 1991, Wexner hands Epstein the keys to his multi-billion dollar empire. He signs a power of attorney agreement that grants Epstein the right to act on Wexner's behalf, stock purchases, real estate transactions, loans, all without Wexner's oversight. Around this same time, Epstein helps Wexner develop a vast community of luxury homes outside Columbus, Ohio. Epstein gets one of these homes at a steep discount. It has 23 rooms, a pool, and a bathhouse. But Epstein's true real estate prize is in Manhattan. Wexner owns a property there that makes even the New York apartments of Epstein's former Bear Stearns colleagues look like dollhouses. Wexner's townhouse is a few blocks from the Met. It's 7 stories tall and 21,000 square feet with a 15-foot high oak door. It's one of the largest private residences in all of Manhattan. But Wexner barely even spends time there. So Epstein moves in 1996. He tells people that he bought the house from Wexner, but there's no public document recording the sale. Epstein will use this mansion to entertain the likes of Bill Clinton, Prince Andrew, the Duke of York, the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, and a young woman who works at this mansion will become one of the first known victims of Epstein's sexual assaults. That's on the next episode of The Mysterious Mr. Epstein. This has been part 2 of 6 of The Mysterious Mr. Epstein. On the next episode, the kid from Coney Island buys his very own island and uses his newfound connection to Victoria's Secret to horrifying ends. If you like stories of far-reaching scandals, listen and subscribe to my series, American Scandal, where we tell the stories from the Enron financial fiasco to the Elliott Spitzer political drama. You can find it by searching for American Scandal in your favorite podcast app. This is a story about power, abuse, and manipulation. If you'd like to help us spread the word, please give us a 5-star review and tell your friends to subscribe. We're available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, CastBox, and every major listening app, as well as Wondery.com. If you're listening on a smartphone, tap or swipe over the cover art of this podcast. You'll find the episode notes, including some details you may have missed. You'll also find some offers from our sponsors. By supporting them, you help us offer this show to you for free. This series deals with issues of sexual violence. If you or someone you know is a victim of sexual assault, reach out for help. In the U.S., you can contact the National Sexual Assault Hotline by calling 1-800-656-HOPE. That's 1-800-656-4673. Or you can chat anonymously with a hotline staffer by messaging the Rape, Abuse, and Incest National Network at online.rainn.org. The Mysterious Mr. Epstein is hosted, edited, and executive produced by me, Lindsey Graham, for Airship. Sound designed by Derek Behrens. This episode is written by Michael Canyon Meyer. Additional reporting and research by Alyssa Jung Perry and Heather Schwering. Associate producer is Caleb Bissinger. Executive producers are Jenny Lauer Beckman, George Lavender, Marsha Louie, and Hernan Lopez for Wondery. Hi, Wondery listeners. If you've ever wanted to listen to the best episodes of your favorite Wondery podcasts all in one place, well, now you can. Introducing The Best of Wondery. The Best of Wondery is a new podcast that features standalone, full-length episodes of some of the most captivating, compelling, and exciting stories from all of Wondery's originals, including Dr. Death, Business Wars, Life is Short with Justin Long, American History Tellers, The Shrink Next Door, and many more. To hear your favorite shows all in one place, search for The Best of Wondery on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or your favorite listening app.